Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. We're going to continue on with this week's theme of saxophone, but not jazz. And I believe, if I'm remembering this band correctly, we're also progressing on with prog-adjacent acts. I think Ishan is probably the least proggy artist we've seen this week, but we have checked out Tesseract and Pink Floyd. Now we're moving into Van de Graaff. This one is The Sleepwalkers. Going to be looking at the 2021 remaster off of the God Bluff album. All right, let's dive into this and see what Van de Graaff Generator is bringing to us today. All right, so we have a 9-beat phrase. Is moved into action, and their pace does not relent. In step with great precision, these dancers of the night advance against the darkness. How implacable their might. And there's variations everywhere. And of course, this section moves to like a 6. So it sounds like the sax is on the right. We have a flute-style synth tone on the left. Might even be a flute of some sort. Yeah, all these odd syncopated hits on the snare too really make it difficult to get a feeling of the groove. Getting this vocal grit. You know, I think that there's a polyrhythm going on there. Yeah, the meter is all over the place. It's so close. It reminds me a lot of Girl from Ipanema. What? Yeah, so we're in 6 and we shift from downbeats to offbeats on accents. Of course, I go to demonstrate it and they change. Ooh. not only is the meter all over the place, but the tempo is as well. Gotta have that spacey synth. Bouncing between these two chords, building a lot of tension and not going anywhere. Yeah, real great time to bring in this groovy idea after, you know, 5 minutes of so much variety. Yeah, really cool counterpoint here with the harmonized sax fizz and then the synth on the left. Love the bass kicks here. Really going for some driving energy, syncopating around that accented snare on the downbeats. Playing around once again with this rhythm though. Messing with the groove. Loving it. Okay, we got wood blocks in here now. Wood blocks are gone. That sounds about right. What is that low tone over there? Too covered up for me to figure out exactly what it is. The instruments lining up with what the vocals are doing. Interesting sound panning there. like a fly buzzing. This, much like a lot of the prog rock we check out, is lengthy and incredibly dense. I'm not sure how strong of an analysis is going to be. What I have in my head, the topics I really want to talk about, are more surface level. I don't have anything right now that I'm really going to be digging into specific sections. It's more about general ideas that they utilize in many of their sections to help them craft a specific vibe and style that is, at least to me, very Van de Graaff generator. I'm also going to do a little bit of comparison. I want to do that first, actually, real quick while it's on my mind. There's that one moment when we came out of the groovy section and we came back to that core sound that we started the song with, what would probably be called the A section of the track. And I had mentioned, oh, you know, there's multiple instruments playing the same thing that the vocals are playing, and we just have this unified melody. It's interesting that I can bring this up because we've actually checked this out twice this week. And usually it'd be like, oh, if you remember that thing way long ago, like, you know, I don't really expect that. But this is recent, right? Frank Zappa and Gong both do this a lot. And it's interesting to hear. I don't have a date on this because it's the remaster. So I don't know what year this came out. But actually, I can. Oh, I'm so close. 75. All right. So yeah, about the same. This was actually the same time as Pink Floyd, was it, right? We checked out Pink Floyd earlier this week, and that was 75 as well. So yeah, not Pink Floyd. Zappa was around this time. Gong, I think, was also 75, 74 maybe. So yeah, all of this happened around the same time. This must have just been a very popular thing to do. It's interesting how you can hear different groups doing it differently. Here it's taken very seriously. It's a way to augment that melodic phrase, whereas in Zappa and Gong, I get more of a playfulness to it. It's done that way to lighten the mood of the song rather than to add depth to it. And here it's done as a contrast to some of the deeper aspects. It's just real interesting to hear that concept being utilized in a way that, at least to me, like I said, is a bit different than what I'm used to. Usually that happens in a more comedic, kind of tongue-in-cheek fashion. I just wanted to point that out real quick. So yesterday, I released a video for Ishan, and in it, I had a small little aside. Had nothing to do with the song itself, but it was sort of my wants out of this week. And something I thought I said I would like to see is classical style saxophone. Not necessarily the sound, well, not necessarily the music for classical saxophone, but the sound of a classical saxophone. It's a different type of air control and embouchure and phrasing that goes into playing a classical piece utilizing an instrument and a jazz piece utilizing an instrument. It was really interesting. I don't think I brought this up yesterday. I used to have classical band, we called it symphonic band class right before jazz band class. And luckily that was also my last two periods of the day. So I just had a blast at the end of my school day. Just got to play music for like an hour and a half, 2 hours, and then go home. Anyways, though, it's a huge shift, right? And we only had like 5 minutes between periods or whatever. But yeah, you have to like completely shift your mindset and your body and like everything moving between these two styles, because they are very different performatively, just as much as musically. So yeah, I wanted to hear more classical style saxophone going through this week, because rock owes a lot to blues, and we've checked out a lot of prog rock, so there's been bluesy aspects in pretty much everything we've checked out. And when you have that bluesy sound with the saxophone, especially when I think most people think of the saxophone, they have a very specific sound in mind, something like Careless Whisper possibly, and they write for the instrument from that perspective, especially if they're not saxophone players themselves. And I think that's what's happened a lot this week, where, yes, it's not jazz, but there's some jazziness going on around it. And I really wanted to divorce that section completely from what we're listening to. I wanted something more classical that happened to be created for the saxophone, rather than the saxophone bringing in its own ideas into music, which typically are a little bit on the bluesier side. And I think I got that today. I think it's kind of awesome. There were, you know, we'll get into the sax solo later on. I do think it moves a bit into the bluesy realm, but a lot of what the sax was doing at the beginning of the song was not. It was not, I don't know if I'd call it straight up classical, but it was written almost as if it was the guitar for the song. And I think that's definitely the way to go about creating a song for this theme. And of course, it's not like these people created the songs for the themes, but they've been suggested for this theme. And, you know, like I said, I do feel like there's been a bluesiness to almost everything we've checked out this week. I think it's just really difficult to divorce jazz and saxophone in rock and metal. Like I said, I think a lot of people just kind of have a specific idea of what the saxophone sounds like. So, actually, let's get into that. Section one, section A, the first part of the song. I don't really know if we can use numbers or letters, because honestly, I have no idea what the structure of this song is. It was very complex, and definitely take a second or third listen to pick up on that. So, you know, I know that this is the first section, but I'm not going to be able to use this format for the whole song. So we're just going to go with that opening idea, the one that we revisited later in the track. I couldn't quite get a read on the time signature, which is going to go along with the structure, and that it was just very dense, right? I think a lot of this song, I'm going to end up saying something along those lines, that I've picked up on something about it, but not all of it. And in this case, the opening idea is 9 beats long. That's interesting. Ignore the technical difficulties. The opening idea is 9 beats long. In fact, I'm going to say 9-4, because not too long after this, the very next section, we shift into a 6, and it's twice as fast, so I'm going to assume that that's 6-8. So we're bouncing back and forth between 9-4 and 6-8 here. However, this 9-4 is not consistent. Sometimes we'll have a 9, sometimes it feels like we have a 10, sometimes it feels like it pushes to 12, and I never quite got the higher level pattern here. I could never figure out where we were going. After a 10 or after a 12, we almost certainly always returned to the 9. So there is a wider pattern that starts on the 9, but I didn't quite really get the flow in between. It could have been a simple 4-bar phrase of 9, 10, 9, 12 or something like that. But, you know, like I said, I never picked up on it. Especially since I'm not 100% on the 9. And I think that's because sometimes the 10 came in. But occasionally I felt like we were actually doing something like 19.8, which is just half of a beat more than that 9.4. And some of that may just be because of the way the 10 feels. Some of it could be because of the way that the accents were working, which is another aspect about this section that made it difficult to parse. The snare did not have a consistent accent to it, especially not one that would go along with the beat. I said it was a 9.4. I felt that in groups of three, which I think is what the guitar was playing on. I think the vocal melody was also dancing around this idea of grouping their notes into three. So it could have been three bars of 3/4, which is a more common time signature than 9/4, but based on the idea that I think we're moving with larger phrases, I think it's easier to envision it as like a 9 and then a 10 and then a 12, rather than more bars of 3 or half bar. The 10 would be a third of a bar. So we would have three full bars and then a bar of 1/3, which would just be, yeah, it's just a lot easier, I think, to not worry about multiple bars per idea. I feel like some of the main melodies were doing these groups of three, but the snare was not accenting 1/4 and 7. They were accenting like 1/3, 5, 6, and then like the and of 8. and that was only one of the times, because I think that their accent pattern was similar for all the nines, but it changed when we had 10s and 12s and whatever other bar lengths that we had. And again, it just lacked the consistency that makes it easy to parse on a first listen. A lot of it seemed to be purposefully to hide behind things, right? Purposefully obfuscating. That word is like, I feel like I say it all the time, and it's a really great word for hiding things. Oh, it purposefully hides it. Man, that's a simple word. Obfuscate's kind of hard to say, though, because of that BF thing in the middle. But anyways, where was it? Oh, yeah. I feel like a lot of the rhythmic ideas are there to disguise. There's another good word. To disguise the core rhythm, the meter underneath everything. And for better or worse, it makes it a very complex sound, right? And I definitely am intrigued by a lot of that. But I don't know that it was always for the better. And, you know, when it comes to stuff like this, it's obviously going to be highly subjective, but there's a line that gets crossed, I think, between listenability and technicality. And there's definitely a place to merge those. And some hyper-technical stuff might be more listenable for some than to others. But there's definitely a line, a subjective line, that gets crossed where a song becomes too technical and loses... I don't know the best way to say this, because again, it's a subjective thing. Some people might feel it's still there, some people don't. But to me, like, the soul of the musics. You know, some people just, they say, you know, it diverges into technical wankery, right? That's a term I've seen thrown out to a couple of highly technical songs that we've checked out in the past. In fact, I used the term masturbatory a couple of times when we talked about Devin Townsend before. Different people have different thresholds for that. This song sits right on the edge, or at least this section. There's definitely parts of the song that rein it back in and go for something more palatable. But this section right here specifically, bouncing between all the different time signatures and having all the different rhythmic components to it, it is like right on the cusp. And I don't actually know how I feel about it yet. Again, this is a song that's going to take a few listens, not only just to grasp, but to understand where I sit with it. And I think this is going to be a make it or break it part of the track. A lot of other sections I understood more easily, or at least, worked with more easily. Then it bounced off of me. This was an interesting, especially since I get thrusted into it immediately. This is one of the first things I heard, and it's... it's just different, right? That's the thing. It's very, I don't want to say adversarial, but it feels like it moves into the realm of saying, hey, Can you figure out what I'm doing? You know, can you listen to me? Right? I have all these great sounds, all these great timbres and tones. Everything sounds neat, but I'm also very confusing, right? Bring it, you know, come check me out. That kind of thing. And like I said, I don't quite know where I sit on it. I don't know if it's too much technicality or if it's just enough yet. I'm right there on that cusp. But again, like I said, that's a subjective thing. I'm sure people listen to that and be like, yeah, that's right up my alley. I love everything about it. You can feel the soul and passion in it. And other people are going to be like, not too much movement, too technical. It's lost the soul of the music, right? Different people are going to have different thresholds for it, and that's fine. Music is subjective anyways. It is art. But that's kind of where I'm sitting with that part, just because of all the rhythmic components. I don't know how I feel about it yet. Now, beyond the rhythmic components, though, we also have melodic components, and there is a lot going on here. We have guitar, a bass, a synthesizer, a flute, a saxophone maybe, and it's all just kind of here. And I think this is interesting because this is a 2021 remaster, and I kind of expected something a little more. And maybe that's where a Steven Wilson remaster would come in. I don't know if Steven Wilson has done any Van de Graaff generator remasters. I know he's a divisive remasterer. I really enjoy his remasters. I know not everybody does. But I feel like this is probably preserving the original essence and just bringing up standards of the audio. Whereas I would want something that expands the audio. Because my big problem right here is that everything feels stacked on each other. And maybe once I understand the lyrics, that's going to make sense, right? Maybe it was done for a thematic reason. But musically, from a purely musical perspective, these instruments need to be spaced out. They are either hard panned left or hard panned right. And there's a couple of ideas that are center panned, and that's it. And I really want some space in the middle. I want some height. I want some depth. I need these instruments spaced out. There's so much going on, and it's difficult to understand or hear any of it because they're just stacked so closely on each other. And again, that's going to be another subjective thing, right? And, you know, I also fully understand that what I would want out of this is not their vision, of course. I'm going to wager that this is close to the original. And obviously, this was remastered, and it kept it this way. You know, this came out yet last year. So, you know, if they were going to remaster it and change it, they had all the tools available to them to widen the sound sphere out and to close the gap between these pannings the way that they are. And they chose not to. So I'm going to assume that this is their vision, and I fully appreciate that. And I also recognize that what I would want out of it is not their vision, but it would desperately help me in hearing all of the ideas here. I do think that there's even some stuff I missed completely because it was hidden under these stacks. There's so much extra room that could be utilized, and it's ignored. And again, that's fine. Artistic vision, right? I'm not the makers of it. But that is something that I would want out of it because of the way that it's layered. So we have all these instruments, though, and they are hard panned or centered. I mean, that's technically, that's zero, right? That's a hard pan. And then 100. Those are hard. Yeah, it's everything's hard panned. And we have a lot of melody coming on each other. We have some harmony. Occasionally, an instrument will line up with what the vocals are doing. I consider the vocals the lead harmony because they're centered. Then we also have counterpoint. We have harmony. We have chordal stuff. We have rhythmic stuff. And we have some textural stuff like what the bass is doing. And even the saxophone, I think, comes in with these ornamental ideas where it'll play like a 4 or 5 note lick and then take a, you know, a bar off or whatever. Just sort of interject these little embellishes against everything else, which I think is a really smart way of going about it because there's so much going on that you really don't want a 5th or 6th melody line in here. It's better just to have these little ideas, these little flourishes to pop up and augment that moment and then allow silence to, you know, impact the rest. So we have these little pockets of ideas coming from the saxophone. That's definitely the best way to go about this, especially with the way that the production is set up, the way that, you know, all the instruments are placed in the sound sphere. And that is this moment. That is this 9-4 plus variation section. We move from here into the 6. I think it's a 6-8, but again, even here, I think we have three bars of 6-8 and then a bar of like 9-8 or 10-8 or something to allow the final bar of this phrase before we pull ourselves back into the next concept or back into where we just were. We bounce back and forth between these two a couple of times to have a bit of a punctuation there, right? Similar, variation. That variation either takes us back and it provides a punctuation to the end of this phrase that we're going to repeat, or it leads us into the next idea, whether that's the idea we just came from or the next one in the song. So even right here, we can hear a lot of variation of the time signature. It's kind of all over the place. Now, because this is in 6-8 rather than 9-4, a different length of note is getting the beat, which makes it sound faster, but I don't think it actually is. Because this easily could be 6-4 with a tempo increase. The end result would sound identical. But instead, I'm pretty sure we switch it off to 6-8. But tempo shifts are also played all throughout this track. And that's the next thing I want to get into. We have time signature changes everywhere. But the time signature changes are the difficulty in parsing what's happening is compounded by the fact that our tempo is also changing constantly. So the first thing that I need to do when I hear a new section is figure out, did we change time signatures or did we change tempos? Once I figure that out, then I can figure out what the time signature is. And sometimes by then we've already moved on to the next section, which is a little frustrating for a first time critical listen, but it also keeps the intensity up. It keeps the mystery up. And it also just keeps the song fresh. I can't say that any part of this track really ever bored me. It was constantly moving to new ideas all the time. That's what constant means. And we even have sonic shifts where different instruments will take on different roles. A lot of the time there are vocals taking the lead melody slot in the middle, but occasionally we'll also hear a guitar come in there. We'll hear the saxophone come in there. And it's just really, like I said, fresh. It keeps the song feeling engaging. There isn't really any moment where there's any strong amount of boredom. It's always moving forward, always moving to the next idea. There's always something changing. If you think the time signature bores you, just wait two bars and there'll be a new one. You know, the tempo is getting a bit boring because you heard it for 2 seconds. Don't worry, they'll change it real soon. It's a constantly evolving song. It feels almost like it's, an amorphous blob that takes one shape one section, and then another shape the next section, and then shifts to another shape. It's just constantly evolving. Not linearly, mind you. It's not progressing towards something. It's just changing randomly all the time. And of course, it's not random. There's a pattern to it, and you know they composed it that way. But so yeah, that's sort of my big overview of this song: is complex rhythms and constantly fluctuating tempo and time signature, mixed with a changing lead vocal or a lead voice that makes every bit of the song feel different. Even if it's an idea we've heard before, there's going to be something new around it, and the song, like I mentioned, for the most part, moves linearly. There are a couple of ideas. Like I said, we jump back and forth between that 9 and the 6 at the beginning. We do bring the 9 back, like 6 minutes into the track. But overall, the song pretty much moves straight forward. So we never really have to worry about hearing a section we've already heard before and getting bored about that either. In a lot of songs, especially ones more cyclical, I talk about this about when I'm listening to music critically, right, and I'm really engaging with every single piece of the song, there is a threshold between when I figured a section out and when the section proceeds to the next. Slow burns take a long time to get to the next section. I've typically figured everything out, and there's a gap of me waiting for the section to move on. The inverse of that would be something like Between the Buried and Me, which is constantly moving before I figured each section out. And, you know, this fits in there as well. In fact, this fits way too well into that. You know, I tend to think of stuff like Between the Buried and Me as an evolution of prog rock, but in a very different direction. But no, there's actually prog rock that, you know, has that same mentality of Between the Buried and Me, where it's just constant harsh changes to ideas that don't necessarily have callbacks to stuff before them. It's all about moving on to the next idea. And I've always kind of, you know, compartmentalized that as prog metal. Right, prog rock was more about the flow, and prog metal is just more about the kitchen sink, right? Throwing everything out there. But no, okay, I'm being shown. There's some prog rock out there that was composed like modern prog metal. There is a lineage there. Very cool. So, anyways, though, you know, I always talk about wanting to be in that sweet spot. As soon as I figure it out, give me a moment to collect my thoughts and move on, right? There's that sweet spot. Most songs don't fit that, of course. And I don't expect songs to fit around my needs. That's ridiculous. But this definitely fits in the opposite spectrum of all the times that I've said, you know, I've gotten a little bored listening to it critically. It might hit differently casually when I can just sink into the vibe. This is the exact opposite, though. This was moving too fast for me. I wasn't picking up on a lot of it, just because it's you know, it feels kind of like ADD in music. We've done this. Now we're going to do that. Now we're going to change time signatures. Now we're going to change tempos. Remember that thing we did? We're going to go back to that. Now we're going to change time signatures again. Now we're going to do something drastically different. Now there's a saxophone you can hear. Now we're back to singing. Now we're back to the six. Then we're going to the nine. It's just constantly, all the time, moving. And I don't know if it's for me. I've had the same criticism with bands like Between the Buried and Me, where even not critically, just listening to it casually, it's just too much going on at once. And it feels almost like change for the sake of change, which, you know, the more I talk about this song, we're going on for, you know, almost 30 minutes now of me just discussing this opening section and my feelings about how the song opened. I do think I'm leaning more into the aspect of it just not being for me. Maybe it is a bit too technical. Because I do kind of feel like it's technical for the sake of technicality. I'm hoping I get proofs wrong. Maybe I look in the lyrics and like there's some thematic cohesion there. Maybe somebody can present an interview, or maybe someone's done a dissertation on this and can say, no, you know, there's a clear reason why they did all this. And I would love to hear it. But where I'm standing right now, after having just the first listen, I do feel like a lot of it is just technical because they wanted to be technical for it. I can't say a lot of the melodic components are reliant upon these composite time signatures. The tempo changes, I think I can forgive a little bit more because they do directly invoke specific vibes and feelings. Slower ones are going to feel more lethargic, faster ones are going to feel more manic, and those are going to bring in their own emotions, especially when you tie them to specific harmonic emotions, like when we can bring in sad tones or happy tones or tense tones, like we combine that with the tempo, like I understand. But all the different rhythmic changes, it really does kind of feel technical for technical sake to me on a first listen, of course. What else do I want to talk about? The saxophone. The saxophone is interesting here because the beginning, right? So I've mentioned this. At the beginning, we kind of have more of a rock saxophone, right? I told you that I felt like the part that it had felt like it was written for a guitar and then given to a sax. And that was something I wanted to see. I had mentioned that in yesterday's Ishan video, that I wanted to see the sax given a part that wasn't bluesy. I didn't care if it was written like a classical piece, if it was written for one of the rock instruments. I just wanted to hear it do something that wasn't bluesy. And I think I got that right there at the beginning. But when the sax came in to do its solo, the phrasing, and it's not even just the phrasing of the licks and how they were formed and composed, it's also the way that the notes are played. There is a little bit of a swinginess to it. A lot of it I felt was 16th notes. So it is a little bit difficult to hear, especially at the tempos they were playing, if they were swung or straight. And I do think that they kind of shifted. Sometimes they would play the 16th note straight, sometimes they would play them swung, but there is a little bit of a bluesiness or a jazziness to the sax solo. It is a drastic contrast from the saxophone's part in the rest of the song, which tends to be, straight eighth notes providing harmonic or textural ideas against everything else that's going on within it, or around it, I should say. And so it's really interesting to give the saxophone more guitar style ideas in the song, but the moment it gets the spotlight, we shift to something a bit jazzier. And I don't think it takes away from the song for the theme. I think the majority of the time we hear the saxophone, it is not jazzy. But I do think it's interesting. You know, we talked about this earlier. It's so difficult for people to write a saxophone piece that just doesn't have the feeling of jazz to it. And, you know, some of that is going to be me. You know, I associate the saxophone with jazz. This is something we've talked about all week. I have, you know, much like a lot of people, when I hear the saxophone, jazz is sort of the first thing I think of. Not classical, not dance music, not rock. You know, it goes kind of straight to jazz. And part of that's just going to be culture. But at the same time, I'm pretty sure they are using some jazzy composition ideas, which are evoking these images, right? The sonic images of jazz. Because when the saxophone was here in the first section, it didn't feel jazzy at all, right? So it is something about the composition or even the way that it's being performed. Like I had mentioned, there's different ways that, air and embouchure and even playing, you know, there is a difference between straight eighth notes and swing eighth notes, and that's going to be about how fast or what kind of weight you give to your fingers as you play the notes that are written out in front of you. There's just a lot of physical elements that come into playing jazz. And I hear them here, compositionally, performance-wise, it feels jazzy. So just wanted to point that out because it is interesting to me. It feels like they went out of their way to do both of these. They made one that was not jazzy, and then they made a melodic line that was jazzy. And I think it's real nice having them paired together here because I can kind of point out how a non-jazzy sax is supposed to feel, especially against that same timbre, probably the same performer, the same production. Like, everything's going to be similar enough that you can hear the compositional elements in the two styles, rather than saying, you know, here's a jazz sax and here's a saxophone in an orchestra, try to figure out the differences. And if you're not musically inclined, you're trying to combat the production on them, you're trying to combat the placement of them in the music, you're trying to combat the different embouchure styles and different performer styles, because we have two different performers. Like, there's a lot of variation here, and at least here we have a constant. This is the same saxophone, same saxophonist, same engineer, just two different styles. And I think might be easier for some people to hear the difference here if they're not musically inclined and have difficulty with that. I know I missed a lot. I missed a lot. Like I said, this was an incredibly dense song. I got a lot of surface level stuff here. But I talked about how they compose melody, how they create counter melody and harmony and texture. I talked about how they deal with rhythms and time signature and the use of saxophone. So I think that's everything I got without getting a second listen on it. And like I said, I know it's a bit of a more surface level listen. That's just gonna happen, man. Right? I am human. You give me some shorter songs or some more shallower songs, and I'll spend half an hour talking about the details. You give me something like this, 10 minutes of just incredibly dense music, and I'll give you 30 minutes of talking about overarching concepts. I mean, it's just, I have a pretty good memory. I don't know why I'm grabbing my headphones. I have a pretty good memory, but it is still a human brain. So let's dive into some lyrics and see what we can find. I heard a lot of words here. Like a lot of words. I'm actually kind of concerned at how long this lyrical section is going to be. It's actually not too bad. So we do have four verses. And we have a bridge interjected in there. And that's it. So yeah, lyrically, this is rather linear. Again, I don't exactly know how this fits into the larger scope of the musical structure. So let's see. It's called The Sleepwalkers. At night, this mindless army, ranks unbroken by dissent, is moved into action and their pace does not relent. In step with great precision, these dancers of the night advance against the darkness. How implacable their might? I might learn a new word. I don't know what implacable is. Obviously, it means unmoving, unwavering, something in that range. Eyes undulled by moon, their arms and legs akimbo, they walk and live, hoping soon to surface from this limbo. Their minds anticipating the dawn of the day, shall never know what's waiting more in sight, mere insight away, too far too soon. So, yeah. Going along with the idea of the sleepwalkers, I'm not sure if that's metaphorical yet, but it says at night, people roam the streets, ready to advance against darkness. They are controlled by something else, though. They're mindless, right? Their pace doesn't relent. They don't have any dissent. They step with precision. They call them dancers of the night. Their eyes are undulled by the moon. Their minds anticipate the dawn. That we'll get into in a second. So yeah, everything is in step. They're being mind controlled somehow. They are not in control of their body. Something else is, right? It's not allowing them to have any thoughts that disagree. That's the no dissent section. They're in great precision, so they're always in step with each other. Calls them dancers of the night. So yeah, it's like one brain is controlling all of them, right? But it says that they hope to surface from this limbo and their minds anticipate the dawn of day. So to me, that sounds like they know they're being mind controlled and they're waiting for daylight to come up so they can wake up and have control over their body again, lining up with the literal idea of sleepwalking. Senses dimmed in semi-sentience, only wheeling through this plane. Only seeing fragmented images prematurely curtailed by the brain, but breathing, living, knowing in some measure at least the soul which roots the matter of both beauty and the beast. From what tooth and claw does murder spring, from what flesh and blood does passion, both cut through the air with the pendulum swing in deadly but delicate fashion. And every range of feeling is there in the dream, and every logic's reeling in the force of the scream, the senses sting, and though I may be dreaming and reality stalls, I only know the meaning of sight, and that's all, and that's nothing. So, yeah, going back to the idea that they understand that they're being mind controlled, we go to that idea of dimmed semi-sentience. Only seeing fragmented images. Curtailed by the brain. But breathing, living, knowing in some measure at least, the soul which roots the matter of both beauty and the beast. So it seems like they are being used, well, called them did it call yeah, it called them a mindless army. And here we're talking about time cutting deadly. Actually there's a lot of ideas here. It says a tooth and claw. So murder comes from tooth and claw, passion comes from flesh and blood, but both of them cut through the air with the pendulum swing in deadly but delicate fashion. Almost sounds like we're moving this into a metaphorical realm where people are sleepwalking through life and they are wasting their passion, waiting to be murdered by time. Right? We only have so much time on here and people are just wasting it sleepwalking. That's the kind of vibe I'm getting here. Maybe we're going to have our narrator who is going to wake them up and be the hero that brings these people out of their slumber, Matrix style, but like 30 years too early. The columns of the night advance infectiously their cryptic dance, gathers converts to the fold. In time, the whole raw world will pace these same steps on unto the same bitter end. So, yeah. It says eventually everyone will fall into this sleepwalker's march. Then we have an interlude. Verse 3 comes up. Somnolent muster, now the dancing dead, forsake the shelter of their secure beds. Awaken to a slumber whose depth they dread, as if the ground they tread would give way. Beneath the solemn weight of their conception, oh, I'd search the hidden corners of all this world, make reason of the sensory whirl, if only I had time, but soon the dream is ended. I don't know what somnolent is. I'm learning a lot of words today. There's a lot of larger words in here, multi-syllabic words, and most of them I've got a read on, but at least two so far. I have no idea. Even like inference, the one I did pick up through inference was implacable. But like somnolent muster, now the dancing dead. Yeah. I can't even pick that one up through inference. Forsake the shelter of their secure bed. So they get out of their beds. They awaken to a slumber whose depth they dread. So that's the sleepwalking, right? So was it semi-sentience is what he said? So they're awake, but they're asleep, and they dread this, right? They dread it as if the ground they tread would give way beneath the solemn weight of their conception. I'd search the corners of this world, make reason of the sensory whirl, if only I had time, but the dream is ended. Final verse. Tonight, before you lay down to the sweetness of your sleep, do you question your surrender to the drop of lover's leap? Or does the anesthetic darkness take hold on its very own? That's a weird word to look at. When you know it's there, you can just gaze past it. But it's got a lot of interesting letter combinations. Or does the anesthetic darkness take hold of its very own? Does your body rise in service with not one dissenting groan? These waking dreams of life and death in the mirror are twisted and buckled. Lashes flicker, a catch of breaths, skin whitening at the knuckle. The army of sleepwalkers shake their limbs and are loose. And though I am a talker, I can phrase no excuse not to rise again. So the narrator seems to also be one of the sleepwalkers. Says, I can speak, I can talk, but, you know, I have no excuse that I still will rise again with them. In the chorus of the nighttime, I belong. I, like you, must dance to that moonlight song. So we all sleepwalk. In the end, I too must pay the cost of this life. If all is lost, none is known, and how could we lose what we've never owned? I'd search every knowledge that I could find, unravel all the mysteries of mind, if only I had time, but soon my time is ended. Yeah, I don't know. Like, it kind of lends me to thinking about Dolly Parton's 9 to 5, right? Where we give so much of our time to our work and our jobs, and it just kind of leaves us tired by the end of the day, and we feel drained, and we spend all of our time for someone else. Not to mention we can bring in consumerism into this and blindly buying things, and now we're wasting so much of our time just doing what others tell us to do, how to work, what to do, what to buy, what to wear, what to watch. You know, we don't actually do much of our own. We're sleepwalking through our lives, and time ends up taking us all. We're limited, right? Of all the resources we have, time is something we cannot get more of. It is limited from the time we are born. And I kind of thought that that's where they were going with this, but by the end, we have this recurring idea of wanting to find more knowledge, searching the hidden corners of the world to make reason of things, if only I had time. And that takes me to a completely different angle, not from the sleepwalking, though. I don't know how to marry these two concepts, but the amount of knowledge someone can gain in a lifetime is, well, small compared to all the knowledge in the world because of time. Eventually, there will be a point where we run out of time but still have more knowledge to learn. And that's what this person sounds like. He wants to learn everything out there. Wants to search the corners of the world to make sense of this place. You know, wants to know the answers of this existence, of this life, of this world, of the galaxy. You know, what is out there? You know, find all the answers to this. Answer the meaning of life. Discover what the human condition is. These larger-than-life questions that still, after thousands, if not millions of years, we still don't have an answer for, and understands that they can't do that. I'd search out every knowledge I could find and unravel the mysteries of the mind, if only I had time. But I'm trying to figure out where these two meet. One feels like it's acknowledgement that we have a limited amount of time, and no matter what I do, I'll never complete everything in it. And the other is an acknowledgement that we waste the time we have. And I suppose there is a connective tissue there, but it just doesn't feel complete. It feels like two different takes on time, almost like it could be two different sets of lyrics, two different songs about time, rather than one that tries to marry both of them. However, it is definitely a song about not having enough time, and it is a song that constantly changes time signatures, as if each idea does not have enough time to be expressed properly. Every time that we want to dig further into an idea or a section of a song, we're moving on. I mean, even in that opening idea, I want to figure out what's going on in that 9-4. If it is 9-4, if it's 18-8, you know, I want to figure that out. But I don't have a chance. As soon as I tried to, we've moved on to a new time. Maybe we're in 10 now. Maybe we're back in the 9, but I think we're in 10. So I count out the 10 and then I get lost, because actually what I think is 10 is now one of the next bar. And when I try to get in on that, now we're actually in 12. And I always feel like I'm one step behind time. What the knowledge I'm trying to find is not possible to find in the limited amount of time I have listening to this song on a first listen and providing an analysis of it. It's actually really interesting how much of that is lining up with my first reaction to this track, is that the time signature, the meter, which also impacts the way that time feels, are actively working against me understanding what the song is doing. And that's exactly what a lot of this latter half of the song is lyrically, is saying that in the larger idea of life, time works against us understanding our current predicament. You know, what it means to live, what it means to be alive, what this earth is, where we sit in the universe. Everybody's time ends too quickly. Too quickly to fully understand everything, and this song, only being 10 minutes long, also ended too quickly for me to understand what it was trying to accomplish. And maybe on a subsequent listen, I would start to understand, much like if I had a second or third shot at life, but could retain my memories and knowledge from previous ones. Fortunately, in the case of music, I have that affordance. I can listen to it again. But in the case of life, we don't. Eventually, our time will end, and we won't have all the knowledge we wanted. But I don't quite understand what the song is saying about that. Part of it seems to be like we're sleepwalking through it, and it's our fault that we don't have enough time, whereas the other half of the song seems to say that there's an acknowledgement that there's not enough time regardless, whether you put all of your energy towards understanding something or if you sleepwalk through it and allowed other people to tell you what to do, it kind of doesn't matter in the end. And maybe that's what it's saying, but at the same time, I kind of get that there is a little bit more of a lust, a want to achieve all this stuff. But despite all that, this person still dances to that moonlight song with everyone else. I don't know. And maybe I'm completely missing the metaphor of the sleepwalking and this dancing at night. That could be for something else. That, in fact, could be a metaphor for death itself, of time taking us. We go to bed alive, and we wake up a sleepwalker. Time has taken us at that point. I don't know. Much like the song, from a first analysis of these lyrics, it is just a hair too vague for me to pick up on a first listen, and it's incredibly dense with quite a few words that went over my head, which that's pretty good, man. I'm not going to sit here and gloat and say I have the best vocabulary and the largest diction of anyone I know or anything like that, because I know it's not true. But, you know, I hope people recognize from how I speak that I have a love for words, right? oftentimes I'll say a word and then spit out like a couple of synonyms for it just because I don't know which synonym is actually the one I want. They all have like minor variances to what they mean. Some are a little stronger, some are a little weaker, some are of a little different take on it. So I like words. And when I see words in a rock song that go over my head, I'm kind of impressed a little bit. Not to say that rock music is stupid or, you know, doesn't use big words, but a lot of rock, I feel, is by, well, a lot of it's by youth, right? Got a lot of garage bands of, like, teenagers putting music out, especially when we look at, you know, modern music coming out and bands in their early days. But I also feel like rock music just kind of is geared towards more of a working class layman type of person. So whether because that's who gravitates to it and they make music for and write lyrics for, or if that's because, you know, they know who their audience is and they aim it for that. I just don't feel like rock and metal typically has a lot of, you know, large vocabulary instances. So it's very cool when I get to see a couple of words and like, oh, you know, I've got some stuff to look up now. Implacable, I gotta go double check, but somnolent, that's that even sounds nice. Somnolent. All right, anyways, those are my thoughts on Van de Graaff generators, the sleepwalkers. This is where you guys come in. Hit me up in the comments. Let me know what you thought of this one, if anything stood out to you, anything you want to correct me on. I know, like I said, very surface level, so I'm up for taking any information you guys want to give me, especially those of you who are huge fans, have heard the song dozens, if not hundreds of times. Let me know your perspective, your insight. You know, this is just incredibly dense. I was not going to get it all in one listen. Above that, if you could, head into the description box. There's a link in there for Linktree. Takes you to this menu right here, has everything related to the channel. Pick up some merch, join the Patreon, join the Discord, follow me on Twitter, submit special selections, everything's in there and more. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. Greatly appreciate all three of those. All right, we have a special selection coming up next. Somehow it's another black metal track. We got two in a row, I think, this week. I honestly have no idea how you guys managed to finagle so much black metal into this channel. Anyways, if that doesn't interest you though, we'll be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC, as usual. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.